How did you become interested in gerontology?
Oh, man. That's not a label that I typically wear, gerontologist.
Okay.
I think of myself more as a scientist.
Okay.
And gerontology is the area where I solve or address problems.
Okay.
And so, I've been a scientist for a really, really long time. I mean, when I was a 5-year-old, I wanted to go to the moon, you know. I'm old enough to remember when they were sending dogs into space. That was a really long time ago. You have to look that up.
Okay.
So I've always been interested in doing research. And I got into gerontological research by working with a guy named Jacob Brody.
Okay.
This was by the time I got to medical school. I went to Howard University in Washington, D.C. And the Aging Institute, which is on the NIH campus, has an epibio unit. And Jacob Brody was the chief of that unit, and he was somebody that I met. And I was in medical school at the time. He said, why don't you come out to our shop and play with our data? And I had, you know, I did a combined MD-PhD program.
Okay.
So I'm a doctor. I call it paradox. anyway, so Jacob invited me out to his office, and I spent 3 months there. And I had a blast. I just worked my PhD's in neuroscience, and I'd worked with the neuroscience people, and they took themselves way too seriously. The aging folks just enjoyed what they did. They asked good questions, and they were very welcoming. If you're a researcher trying to do research, you need to find a shop where people want you. And so the first problem I ever worked on was hip fracture. And differences between men and women and different racial and ethnic groups in the risk of hip fracture. So that's really, if you want to start the counter, is where I started getting interested in problems of late life.
Okay. So that takes us right into the next question. So you began with that initial interest. So describe for me your career trajectory.
Oh my God. Oh my God. Let's see. So I'm from Kansas City, Kansas. I went to all black schools. It was segregated at the time. They were busing people to achieve segregation. I don't know if you know or are aware of that. You're not old enough to remember that. But I was a graduate of Sumner High School in Kansas City, Kansas. Okay. And it was a... Not only were the students segregated, but the faculty was segregated as well. So we had some fabulous teachers. We had people with masters, and because they couldn't teach anywhere else. In Kansas at the time, if you were a woman and you got pregnant, you had to leave.
The state?
You had to leave teaching.
Oh, okay.
No, you could stay at a state. Okay. You just couldn't teach anymore. Imagine how many women give up their jobs now because they're pregnant. Mm. It doesn't happen anymore. Well, it did. Back in the day. So in that system, though, I had some fabulous science teachers. I had a great science teacher named Mr. Pitts in junior high. I had a couple women who were math teachers who were really good. Ramona Townsend, not only was she a great algebra teacher, but she was gorgeous. So I had some really good role models of being a scientist and doing research. And so at Sumner, they encouraged us to go to college. So I went to Northwestern University in Evanston, Illinois. Mm-hmm. Yes, the Northwestern Wildcats. Bottom of the Big Ten. We used to be bad in football. But, you know, doing research, met my husband there. We're still married 42 years. And then I worked for a while because I was, sort of fed up with higher education and the struggle that you have as a minority person. This is now in the 70s.
Okay.
and so worked as a lab tech at the University of Kansas in the pathology department. And I sort of realized that I was as smart as anybody I was working for. So I decided to go to medical school, because that was something I'd always wanted to do. And I got into Howard, but I come from a very modest background. I mean, my parents are high school dropouts, right? They were 16 when I was born. So I always needed money to go to school. And my husband worked to put me through medical school, but, you know, it was not easy. So I went to work as a freshman medical student for a professor in the anatomy department. And he, at the end of the summer, he's like, you have a PhD dissertation here. Why don't you take some time out of medical school and get a PhD? That was not what I had planned to do. You know, I was going to go straight through. I was going to learn how to take care of people, go back home, practice. And when he said, I'll pay you, sold. I'm there. So Sal Rapisardi, Sicilian guy in the middle of all black Howard, took me on as a graduate student. And we have, so one of the first papers I ever published is Rapisardi and Miles. If you look it up, it's all about neuronal connections in the cat brain. It's a classic now. And so that, you know, that kept me going as a scientist and doing inquiry. And I was the second person in Howard's history to ever get a combined MD-PhD. This was in, we're talking about 1980. There were no combined MD-PhD programs. Very few in the country. So the first one was a guy, and then I was next. And so that was kind of cool. When I finished up at Howard, I was still tracking toward practicing clinical medicine, though. So I did it was during the third year, no, the fourth year at Howard that I did some time as a medical student at the National Institute on Aging. That's where that piece fits into the line. You made the mistake of asking me about my career. It goes like this.
Go
ahead. It goes like this, right? But I still wanted to get a residency because you can never have too many, in this world, you gotta have enough certifications to be able to work. So I applied for residency in internal medicine at the Washington Hospital Center, which is what people do after you graduate from medical school. The traditional track is you go into a what they call a residency. So I did a year of internal medicine there. That's when I kind of decided at that point, because I had broken up my medical education with 2 years of full-time graduate study, I was older than most. I was older when I got into medical school because I worked between undergrad and medical school. And then I took that period of time out to get the graduate training. So I was 30 when I graduated from medical school. I wanted to get on with my life. My husband was like, are you ever going to make any money? No, he's been completely supportive the whole time. But during the residency program, I circled back to the folks at NIA and I said, I really would like to learn to do research better. It was either be a clinician, that was a fork in the road, that's a decision tree. Be a clinician and really do the clinical thing, or be a better researcher. And so I opted for the research track. And so with the help of the folks in the epidemiology branch at NIA, Jacob Brody was still in charge at that point, I got a postdoctoral fellowship and did 2 years of flat-out research training. And that's when I started working on the hip fracture problem using epidemiologic methods. Some people call it population health now. And basically published papers that used existing data to get at the differences between men and women. Men fracture their hips in old age. They just do it at a later age. And it relates to the underlying biology. So if your bone starts to decline, I wave my hands a lot because my husband says I can't talk without waving them around. All of us undergo bone loss after a certain period of time. Men start out with higher levels of bone, so they get to the clinically important parotid range at an older age. So you'll see guys in their 80s and 90s who fracture their hips the same way women do at an earlier age, and they're just as at risk for all the problems. So that was one of the things that we were able to tease out of the data. And then he asked me, Jacob, I like Jacob because he was always provocative. I mean, he was an epidemiologist. He worked on the epidemiology around Hiroshima and Nagasaki and slow viruses. I mean, Jacob Brody was a fabulous thinker. So he said, well, why is it black women don't fracture their hips the way white women do? And I'm like, ooh.
That's right.
Because that's how research starts. You go, I don't know what the answer is to that question. So we spent time looking at the national data at that point, which only went up to age 75. Keep in mind, this was like back in the 86, 87. We only had data up to that age. And when you looked at the rates, black men and women and white guys all had the same age-specific hip fracture rates. It was white women who were the outliers. They had higher rates of hip fracture at earlier ages. So that's what I told them. I went back and I said, there's nothing wrong with black women. It's this other group that's different from everybody else. And so then what I was able to do was use my anatomical training to ask, why? What's the difference there? And so, you know, long story short, we did some look at muscle mass, body mass index, all that other stuff. And anyone who has a higher body mass index or who has more muscle is going to have denser bone. And so that explains some of the population differences we were seeing at the time. That's what I mean about being a scientist. The other thing we came across, though, was a geographic variation in hip fracture rates. And when you mapped them, subsequently to that, I worked with somebody who mapped on a national level using Medicare data. We created a county level map of hip fracture rates, and the highest hip fracture rates were in the southeastern United States. Okay? Surprised by that?
I am.
Okay, so the question is, number one, did we make a mistake? Or if we didn't make a mistake, what explains this difference? Mm-hmm. And so the first thing we did was we went back and said, okay, let's make sure we didn't miscode something or do a calculation wrong. And sure enough, and we showed it to people who had done this before, who were looking at other injuries. And they said, no, you did that correctly. So then we had to ask ourselves, well, what are the risk factors for hip fracture? Basically, it's thin blondes who smoke, and there's a genetic piece to it, and there's dietary factors, okay? So, you live in the Southeast. We don't have many blondes around here. People are certainly not thin. And women don't really smoke, right? So, what is it that explains this hip fracture? Well, subsequently, after I left the NIA, I had a graduate student who picked up this problem. And what he was able to identify is that we were looking at a birth cohort effect. Okay? So let's see if I can line the timeline up for you. In 1988, when Steve Jacobson, who's now himself a full professor, recreated the map, and got the same finding, we started to look at that birth cohort's history. Those women were basically born, we're talking about women who were 65 and over. Those women were basically born in the early part of the 1900s, right? Women who, especially the ones who lived all their lives in the southeastern United States, passed through two, what we propose to be critical nutrition windows. One of them was pellagra. Do you know what pellagra is? It's a niacin deficiency disease. So it's a diet that's deficient in this case, meat and milk. And so people who don't get enough of those things will have disorders of of skeletal formation. And so that was, we put that observation together with some classic work by Joseph Goldberger, who's the father of American epidemiology. He is the one who used pellagra outbreaks in the United States to build our confidence here in epidemiology. And so his data showed us that it was happening in the southeastern United States. We actually pulled some of his data from parts of South Carolina, the mill towns. He went and studied. Do you know what I'm talking about? You don't know what I'm talking about.
As far as mill towns?
Uh-huh.
Yeah, I grew up in one.
Okay. All right. So the mill towns, if you look back in the history, the families who lived in the mill towns, you know, they didn't get a lot of money for what they did. So men were preferentially fed meat, you know. The women and children, not so much. And so that's where you saw pellagra.
Okay.
Those children grew up to be women who fractured their hips. And the only thing that offset it, according to the analysis that Steve did, you look up all these papers, that's a nice thing. You put in Steve Jacobson and you will pull up his papers. If you grow up in a county where the water has excess calcium in it, your risk for hip fracture due to this problem is reduced. Because you're getting calcium from another source. So it's a nice example of birth cohort effects. This cohort, if you look after about 19, people were born after 40, 45, a couple things happen to lower the risk of hip fracture, and you don't see hip fracture near women, nearly at the rate among comparably aged women now that you did then. Part of what happened was they figured out how to raise dairy cattle in the South. Before 1940, you couldn't do it. There were bugs and things that just, you couldn't raise dairy cattle here and have them be healthy. So milk was in short supply. And the overall nutrition of the country improved. So what we thought was normal aging, i.e. hip fracture, no, it was a birth cohort effect. And then we confirmed that sort of thought process by looking around the globe for other cohorts that had skeletal problems. So what you saw in the black community in the South was rickets. You've probably seen photographs of kids. You know what rickets kids look like?
Uh-huh.
They got those bow legs.
Yeah.
That's a vitamin D deficiency. And so that's why milk now had supplements for vitamin D in it. I love aging because it's like, it gives you, you can pull all this stuff together and you can see stuff. So you got through medical school, right?
Mm-hmm.
Through the postdoc, and now I'm into my first job as a faculty member in the School of Public Health in University of Illinois in Chicago.
Okay.
And that's where we did the, I call it the quartet of papers on hip fracture. While I was there, by the way, I got that job because Jacob Brody took the deanship there. And I called him up and I said, you know, I finished my postdoc. I really like what we've started. You know, would you be interested in hiring me? And he did. So I joined the epidemiology faculty. That's why, even though I have medical training in internal medicine, PhD in neuroscience, I consider myself to be an epidemiologist because that's sort of the tool belt. Scientists have a tool belt, and that's the tool that I use the most. So the hip fracture work I did in Chicago. The other big thing I did in Chicago that is a thread that continuously runs through my career is so NIA wanted to know more about the process that makes people become frail as they age. At that point, now we're now into the early 90s, and we don't know much about frailty. Everybody knows it when they see it, but we don't have an operational definition. We don't have anything clinically. We don't understand it. We don't understand how people get there. And, you know, the population is... So they came out with an RFA, a request for applications on that topic. And one of my colleagues in the department, Jack Goldberg, had a twin registry of Vietnam era twins. It's a big deal to have these population registries of twins. You can look at both environmental and genetic factors to tease them apart in their role in causing problems. So Jack had a big experience with the Vietnam era twins and the World War II twins, but they were all men. And so Jack Goldberg, who's now University of Washington, he used to walk the hallways with a can of Coke and stick his head at your doorknob, you know, what do you do? That's the way Jack worked. He and I came up with a scheme for identifying possible twins in the Medicare enrollment file. Okay, because there's nothing out there that says you're a twin. Now in Scandinavia, because people register births, they can track twins across the life course. And so we were also collaborating with the twin registries in Sweden. But in the United States, you know, we value our freedom. We don't want government interference, blah, 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 blah. So we miss out on a lot of stuff. So using a algebraic equation, we were able to take the digits in the Social Security number, gender, age, the frequency or the rarity of the last name, and come up with a score that said this pair of records have a high probability of being twins.
Okay.
Because you don't have the other stuff that would say, yeah. So we got a grant from NIA to start the process of estimating what it would take to build a registry. And so those papers are out there too, you can see them. With some help, we worked closely with the folks at the Social Security Administration, and it worked out really well. We estimated that there, at the time, 50,000 pairs of twins over the age of 65. I mean, you know, it's a big country.
Goodness.
And there's a lot of old people in it, and people are living longer, right? So, we called, because I was funded to study African Americans specifically, it's called the Black Elderly Twin Study, or BETS for short.
Yeah, like acronyms, huh?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, oh, that's a coin of the realm in science. You know, you drink a lot of beer and you hang out in the bar and you come up with acronyms. Now, it turns out in Sweden, the acronym for their twin study, if translated into English, means take a chance. So I thought that was kind of cool, some symmetry there. Anyway, so long story short, we were able to assemble, because money always limits the amount of research you can do, about 300 pairs. And we've published. We've continued to publish. The last paper that we published on the pair was in 2010 on genetic and environmental factors contributing to the presence of depression in late life. Because everything you are in old age is a dance between G and E. You ever seen Fred Astaire and Ginger Rogers dance?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So, you know, sometimes G leads, mm-hmm. sometimes E leads, you know. And different traits, depending on what it is, have different degrees of causal pathways. So the study of the development of frailty is the other piece of concept that I've been working on in one way, shape, or form ever since.
Okay.
So I'm in Chicago at the University of Illinois School of Public Health. You with me, Samantha?
Mm-hmm. I'm with you.
Okay. I also had, at that point, my daughter was born in 88. She's now 27. And, you know, my husband and I are doing what people do, living our lives. And I had a chance to meet in the United States, there was a group at Penn State University who actually created the Swedish Twin Registry.
Okay.
It was started by a guy named Gerald McLaren, McLaren, who's now retired. That's the thing about getting old. It's like all your buddies start to pop off. It's scary because, you know, it makes you know that you're aging too. Anyway, so Jerry started the Swedish Twin Registry, and we got the idea that it might be nice to run some parallel analyses because, you know, they're Swedes. I've got African-American twins. There's Finnish twins. By this time, twin registries are popping up everywhere. So he recruited me to come to Penn State as faculty. Now that was in the middle of nowhere, and I lived in the middle of downtown Chicago in a 25-story high-rise apartment building. You know, State College, Pennsylvania is you know. Mm-hmm. But I talked to my husband, and Chicago has always been a dangerous place. You know, they talk about the murder rate in Chicago, but it's always been a dangerous place. So, you know, we moved. Thought it might be a good place for our daughter to be, to grow up. He was a trailing spouse. I mean, he has a bachelor's degree, but, you know, he's basically been staying at home with her, or staying at home at the time with our daughter. So we moved there, and one of the things I'm hired to do is start the Center for Special Populations in Health, which is still, to this day, active. It was a very different environment, you know, not a medical school, you know, it was your big time football university, like, like here in Athens, and they got snow. So at Penn State, I did more twin work, learned a lot of new, learned how to do quantitative analyses of related individuals. So twin and family study data, which is not easy to do because there's variance attributable to genetics and there's variance attributable to non-genetic factors. You know, one member of the pair smokes is one way to think about it. But I learned how to do all that stuff. Learned how to, so there's a bunch of papers from that period that are focused on twin studies and the body composition and cognitive stuff that contribute to the development of the diseases of aging. So you can see that, if you look at those papers, that's that period. But I also had the opportunity to meet and start working with a guy named Mark Hayward, okay, who's a demographer. He was at Penn State at the time. Love Mark. Love Mark Hayward. He's a gerontologist, and he thinks about how early life exposures influence adult health in late life. And he does beautifully. He's a big D demographer. So I had a chance to work with him on some things. He's done work on premature exit from the workplace. So that kind of stuff. And to this day, we still stay in touch and dialogue and things. And I also had a chance to work with Keith Whitfield and his wife, Linda Burton. Werner Scheide. I don't know if you know Werner. You know Werner?
Scheide, yes.
Yes, of course. Everybody knows Werner Scheide. Yeah, one of his graduate students, whose committee I served on at Penn State, is now at Duke. Hayden Bosworth. Uh-huh. I was on his graduate committee. I have more than 75 PhD and professional students that I've served on committees. I was at a meeting once, and one of my former graduate students came up with her PhD student. And I felt like a grandparent. I was like, oh, she's gorgeous. Oh, my God. It's you hang around this business long enough, and you start to collect these things. Anyway, so Penn State was a good experience for getting my skill sets as a scientist down, quantitative skill sets, and learning more about, you know, other aspects of things in a more traditional environment. But I really missed disease and decay. You know, I am a physician. I'm used to people dying. And in at Penn State, the joke was, if they're dying, we send them to Hershey, where the medical school is. So I also missed people of color. There were like, this was in Centre County, C-E-N-T-R-E County, Pennsylvania at the time. There were probably 250 black people. So, you know, it was okay, but, you know, I had to come out of Chicago. So anyway, so I got recruited to San Antonio, Texas.
Okay.
University of Texas Health Science Center, by a former classmate of mine from medical school, Charles Mouton, M-O-U-T-O-N. Charles was at Howard when I was at Howard. His class was a year behind mine, and so when he did his neuroscience rotation, as a medical student, you do a month of neuroscience, or at the time you did a month of neuroscience. I was in graduate school TAing the class.
Okay.
So, you know, I've known Charles like forever. He's like, you know, you should come to San Antonio. They're now in a clinical, in the medical school, in the Department of Family and Community Medicine, so it's family practice people. And he and a fellow by the name of David Espino run the geriatrics program. And so that is the only minority-led geriatrics program in the country at that time. David Espino is Mexican, or of Mexican, he's Mexican-American. But San Antonio is Mexican-American. What most people don't realize until you live in Texas is the Mexicans have always been there. It's us who move the border around.
Mm-hmm.
So that's his home. You know, we're just visitors. So it was kind of cool. The three of us did a lot of work on Mexican elders. So you'll see from that period, lots of work with the Hispanic Epis. Hispanic Established Populations for Epidemiologic Studies of the Elderly. That's why we call it H-E-P-E-S-E for short. Cocos Marcades is the PI of that project. It still goes on to this day. And we published many, many papers off of that one. The things I specialized in were things like incontinence and gait. But we published all kinds of stuff. We also had a Hartford Center of Excellence in geriatrics training. So we trained many, many geriatricians from Latin America. We had people from Colombia and Guatemala and Mexico, because the world is aging, and those are areas that need geriatricians just like we need them here. What else did I do in San Antonio? Oh, we had a faculty band. We called ourselves Doctors After Hours, because Charles could play saxophone like nobody's business. He's from New Orleans and was almost a semi-pro. I played piano. I always wanted to learn to play jazz, and so I did that. And we had a bass player who was a statistician during the day, and he played... Ray could really... So I had Charles and Ray, not Ray Charles, but Charles and Ray in the band. And one year, we got a new chairman during that time named Carlos, and Carlos played congas. And so we played once a year in public at the departmental Christmas party.
Okay.
And, you know, we weren't half bad. I mean, people would dance, and the more you drink, the better we would sound. Was great. So, you know, we did our science, but we also had a good time. And we taught a lot of people. So San Antonio, and of course my daughter and my husband were living their lives around all of that craziness. So, you know, we were there for a while. Do you have any questions for me? I'm going to stop talking for a second.
No, you're fine. I'm writing.
No questions?
Well, do you want to keep going with your career trajectory and then I'll go to the next question. I want you to tell me all about your career trajectory.
Okay, you asked for this.
I did.
All right. So, higher education is a very volatile place. Okay? Politics change overnight, leadership changes. And Texas is a very misogynistic place. So you can imagine, or maybe you can't, what a difficult navigating that the waters in Texas, not being a man and not being Mexican, created for me. So that part of it slows down the progression of the science. My colleagues directly that I was directly involved in geriatrics were great. I would work with them, and I still do, in a heartbeat. But the larger environment around us got to be more and more unnavigable. There were some people who didn't like the fact that we were a minority-led shop. So I got an offer from the family medicine group in Louisville, Kentucky, to run their research unit. Got the offer of an endowed chair, which is, not too shabby. Louisville was building its program at the time. And it was a good transition. My daughter was just about to enter high school. You can't move your kids all the time. You have to be very, if you care about them. If you don't, move them around like chess pieces. But if you care, you have to be cognizant of what stage they're at when you move them. So she was about to enter high school, so it was an opportune time to move her. And my husband is like, if they're paying you more money, let's go. So I moved to Louisville, Kentucky. So I was still inside of medical school and in a clinical department, not a basic science department. So it's the Department of Clinical and Geriatrics Medicine. Family and Geriatric Medicine. Too many titles here. James O'Brien, who is as Irish as that name sounds, was chair. And we built geriatrics training for all levels of medical students. We had geriatric fellows, and my job was basically to get them, to teach them how to do research within what's possible for a clinician, because their primary focus is taking care of patients. But they all would pick up a project and present it at the American Geriatric Society meetings. It was part of how we got evaluated by the national organization. We created clinical learning for the third year medical students who were coming through the geriatrics rotation in family medicine. It was the first time we were starting to use case-based learning. So we would give them a case, and the way doctors are trained, they write SOAP notes. So subjective, objective assessment and plan. Mm-hmm. Subjective is what the patient tells you. Objective is the lab data that you collect. And assessment is what you think is going on. So you have this sort of list of, if it's this, it must be that, and blah, blah, blah. And then your plan is rule out, blah, blah, blah. Well, with geriatrics, if a person wets their pants, which is very common, it could be all kinds of things. So we had to teach them the process of unbundling what would be the thing that's most likely to be causing this, and what can you do about it. That's not easy, but it's, I think, highly rewarding when you can even do it like that. And so we developed a method. People presented it at the Society for Teachers of Family Medicine. It's a strategy that other people were using around the country. So I can't claim sole ownership, but we refined those methods. And now doctors in their fourth year of medical school have to pass a national exam where they demonstrate their ability to examine a patient. You know, before they just would bring a patient, when I was in medical school, they just bring you in there and somebody would show you what to do and then you grope around until you figured it out. Well, we have standardized patients now. And the people who function as standardized patients can give you feedback. So we're quite, the way we teach doctors to interact with patients has evolved over the course of my career. So I was also responsible for teaching physiology to residents. This is why I have the best physiology of aging lecture in the country. It is not a cascade failure phenomenon. And also did research. And so in that environment, what was possible was practice-based research. How do you, by that point in time, we knew, you know, because I've been thinking about frailty and the development of frailty, we knew enough to say in a clinical encounter, if you do not assess the person's cognitive abilities, you don't know whether they understand you or not. This is why I keep asking you questions. Are you getting this? Mm-hmm. Only you ask people those questions in a way that they have to respond to you, so you know. So at one point, we had 25 individual primary care practices linked in a network. So we take one problem and go through each of the practices to see what that problem looked like. And where we started was cognitive impairment. Clot drawing, specifically. If you take a tool into a practice setting, the tool has to be easy to administer, it has to be cheap, it has to be informative, and it can't take all day because okay. practitioners don't have a lot of time. So we went in and to recruit the practices, basically I said, look, I'll have the, for a week's worth of patient visits by adults, and I mean all adults, not just the old ones, I'll ask them all to draw a clock while you get their height, weight, temperature, you know all that stuff you do when you first go to the doctor. I'll ask them to draw a clock using a standardized protocol. We'll collect the clocks at the end of the day, we'll scan them, we'll score them on a four-point system, and I will show you last week how many cognitively impaired people you saw. Okay? And so that's what we would do. I had a social work graduate student working with me at the time and a medical student. And the clock drawing is very deceptively simple. People are not upset because the people who cannot draw a good clock don't know that they're not drawing a clock. So, you know, now their family members get really upset when they see that because it reveals something about that person that the family member's been like this. So basically, I would give you a piece of paper, and I would say, with a pencil, with an eraser, and I would say, I want you to draw a clock, put the hands on the face at 1:45, and make it so that a child can read it. And then I would give them a second, and they, you know, have them repeat the directions back. It's not a time test. People can take as long as they like. Go. And you could tell, I've got 1,400 bad clocks, because we scanned them all. And then the next week, we come back to the staff, and we, you know, give them breakfast and donuts or something. And we run all the clocks by them. And they go, oh, my God. You know, so we picked up all these people who had cognitive impairment who were, like, in their 30s. 40s. I mean, people, young people, it's not just an old people problem. We just don't become aware of it until people get to be old.
Right.
We were, talk about timing. This is now, we're now talking about the early 2000s, right, when I'm in Louisville. And methamphetamine is spreading across the United States, right? It starts out on the West Coast, and it's moving east. And so during the period we're collecting these clocks, and our clinics are in central Kentucky. Louisville's in central Kentucky, right across the river from Indiana, out west to Paducah. So we got clocks during the period that meth was starting to move through Kentucky. It was amazing.
Bad clocks.
Bad clocks from really young, bizarre looking clocks. From really young, we had this one young woman who was 24 and had this 3-year-old, and she drew the most bizarre looking clock I'd ever seen. I mean, this is, you know, there's clocks that are drawn by people with dementia, and then there's meth clocks. And we could see it, you know, and it was something the clinicians couldn't see yet. Although people who really have been doing meth for a long time have some stigmata that if you're aware of it, you know, their teeth are bad and their hair is all... Before they get there, they draw these bad clocks. So we were able to pick up all of that. And so it was wonderful that we were starting to show clinicians that this was a way of doing, picking up easily people who are having problems. Because if you can't follow directions to do a clock, you can't take your medicines properly or wound care, any of that stuff. And so it's more than just an educational issue. It's a brain issue. And the way you solve that is by having a caregiver in the room listening to the instructions. You know, people shouldn't go see the doctor alone. I'm convinced. So it was frustrating because we hit a wall with that problem. We couldn't, there was no money in the system and no will to take that to the next level. And at the time, what I heard is, well, it's not policy. This is not policy, or we can't get paid for it. And after a while, I was thinking, who is this guy policy? Let's just shoot him and get it over with. Not that I'm a shooter, okay. But so in the spring of 2008, the Health and Aging Policy Fellowship was launched by Atlantic Philanthropies. And they, Harold Pincus, P-I-N-C-U-S, is the leader of that, was the leader of that idea. And he basically thought that we could get better healthcare policy, you know, payment policy, for older adults if we took people who have the geriatrics background and put them in a policy setting so they could talk to the you know, on reflection, it's like, no, what happens is the aging people get corrupted, but that's another story. Anyway, so I stopped at a booth at the American Geriatric Society meetings to talk to some people who were running the booth, because I was thinking one of my younger colleagues could do this fellowship. You know, they have you for a year in Washington, you get to hang out working with policy people. This was brand new. And I thought, okay, it's great. And Foon, who was the deputy director at Foon Train when, don't ask me to spell that name, said, you know, we do old people too. She's talking to me. You know, I was frustrated because I couldn't go any farther with my studies in the clinic. I was just, because we knew all this stuff. We knew what to do. We just couldn't do it. So I applied. And I got accepted as a fellow. So in October of 2008, when the world was in chaos, you're probably not old enough to even remember.
I was graduating high school.
Yeah, see, you didn't have the open the envelope on your retirement accounts going, oh my God. You know, the economy was falling into the toilet and people were losing jobs everywhere. And, you know, here I was taking off to live in Washington for a year or so working on the policy thing, but it was the most amazing experience. So I would call this a second postdoc. We got training in legislative processes. So all that stuff with the bills and the votes and cloture. I know all about that stuff now. I know how to read laws. Because what I did was, what you have to do as a policy fellow is you have to sell yourself to some office. You know, you make the rounds. And I had to take, imagine, I'm a very senior person at that point in time. with a 30-page resume. I had to distill it down to 2 pages and give it to a 25-year-old who went, that's what life is like on the Hill, who worked for these senators. And anyway, so there were seven of us, and five of us wound up working for senators who were on the finance committee. So it was very, very cool. And we were in competition with the Robert Wood Johnson Fellows, which were very established, and we beat them out. So I'm so proud of that. I can't tell you how proud I am of that. And so we were on the scene when Obama got elected. I was in Washington the night they announced his election. It was pandemonium. It was good pandemonium. People were like screaming his name in the streets. There was some guy with a horn going, Obama! You know, it was nuts. But it was very cool because no one expected him to win, right? No one expected him to win. So I was there when the inauguration. I didn't go down to the inauguration. It was too crazy. Washington was too crazy, and it was bitterly cold that day. It was horribly cold. But I was there on the scene, sort of watching that early experience and working on the Senate Finance Committee, which finance. I don't know if you know what finance has jurisdiction. What you have to think about in Washington is what the committee has jurisdiction over. The Finance Committee has jurisdiction over Medicare, Social Security, taxes, trade, all the big, anything that is financed that needs policy for how the government is going to write checks, that's the Senate Finance Committee. So I learned all about unemployment insurance. At one point I had to staff a hearing on whether or not they were going to raise the amount of money they give unemployed people. Because we went through a period where, you know, they had to come up with policies because more, I don't know if you remember the bikini graph. You probably don't even know what I'm talking about. There was a month-to-month graph about how the number of jobs that were lost each month. And it looked like a bikini.
Oh, I didn't know it was called a bikini
graph. Yeah, if you start in the fall of 08, you got, you know, bars going down. Well, it reaches a nadir around March. And so it really looks like a crotch shot. And then the bars get...
Okay.
And then after that, just Google bikini graph and it will come up. Rachel Maddow was really fond of showing it. And so was Ezra Klein, is one of my favorite analysts. Anyway, so that was during that period. And so we had to come up with ways to pay for the unemployment benefits. And there was a lot of politics around that. So I got to see all of that stuff. I was a fly on the wall. It was amazing, amazing. And I came away from that with a real ownership of government in a way I just, you know, government's for other people.
Right.
No, it is not. It belongs to us. So that's how I got into policy, which is what I do a lot of right now.
Okay. I do have one question, and it's not on here.
Okay.
Okay, so in the beginning, you were telling me about you grew up in Kansas during segregation.
Right.
So how was that being in Washington when Barack Obama is elected president, coming from, you know...
That background, yeah. It was unreal. I mean, I was 14 when they landed a man on the moon, and I would say Obama getting elected was even more... I mean, you know, I lived through the riots... In the 60s, I have a grandmother who lived in Watts when they burned it down. I mean, you know, I'm a child of the 60s, and being born at the peak, I was born at the peak of the boom. All of this. I have classmates who went to Vietnam. You know, I am a part of that group, and it's just, him being elected was like, stop.
I can only imagine. That's amazing. So, we kind of talked about this during the first question about embracing gerontologist as a term to describe yourself.
Mm-hmm.
And you said you don't describe yourself as a gerontologist.
No, because it's too... Okay, here's the problem. It is important to me to be able to communicate with everybody. And calling yourself a gerontologist excludes all the other age groups. It really does. And I'm not so much interested in old people, although I've spent most of my career studying old people. I am more interested in the changes that happen in society around them. I mean, this past year, my group published 4 papers on the health effects of grief and loss on the survivors, from a public health perspective. Because in a society, and I'll send you, if I haven't sent you the PDFs, I'll send them to you. In a society of long lives, we know people now far longer than we ever have. If you think about it, I mean, I'm 61. I have known my parents for 61 years. That's a really long time. Mm-hmm. And it doesn't matter how old you are, when your parents die, it has an effect on you. So we have millions of people. I actually did the estimates for Georgia. Every year there are 1 million newly bereaved people in the state. I did that work when I first got here with some phone calls. I haven't published it yet because I can't get anybody to publish. It took me a long, well, we'll get into that story. Anyway, so we picked up a national cohort called the Health and Retirement Survey Cohort. These are people, we took the part where people were between the ages of 50 and 70. And we looked at the volume of losses they were experiencing and whether or not that had an impact on their health, and measured in very concrete ways. So we couldn't do every relationship they had because the survey didn't collect all that, but we looked at loss of a parent, spouse, sibling, or child. And so in that age range of life, people are losing a lot of folks. I mean, if you just sort of think about it and talk to your friends, you know, you're losing a lot of people. And in medicine, we just say, oh, get over it, you know, or time, you know. Or if someone comes to you complaining about not being able to sleep, you give them a drug. You know, we haven't yet processed what that volume of loss means for the overall public health. And this is population level health. So those 4 papers focus on that question. So one paper basically estimates the prevalence of people who are newly bereaved. By the time you get to be 70, over 80% of the cohort has experienced a loss in one of those 4 categories. Mm-hmm. There's about, I want to say 20-25% that have had 2 or more losses. And so the more losses you have, the more likely you are to die yourself, be hospitalized overnight, visit a doctor more than 20 times in a year, or have insomnia, clinically important insomnia. Those are the endpoints that we could pull out of the data. Those are not insubstantial problems.
Right.
And when we talk about the cost of healthcare and healthcare utilization, we have not, as a culture, factored in grief. It weighs on people. The gerontology community studies spousal loss, but they don't study parental loss, which for, like I said, if you're in your 60s and 70s and your parents, like my parents are, 16 years older than you are, we're going to be old people together.
Mm-hmm.
And so that makes a difference. And it doesn't matter if the person has lived, if you think, oh, they've lived a good life. So what? You still lose them. So I think what we've been, so some interesting statistics that come out of that work, even though in a nation of over 300 million, about 5% of people, there are 2.5 million deaths every year. So somebody somewhere has lost someone. They're freshly bereaved. The net effect of that loss gets worse over time, not better. There's a Swedish researcher named Mike Rostella, who wrote a really fabulous paper called Time Does Not Heal All Wounds. Great paper. And if you ask me or remind me, I'll send you that paper. He basically looked at, because in Sweden they have better population registries, the probability of dying after the loss of a parent. He wrote separate papers, one about parents, one about sibs. Your own risk of dying after that event continues to rise for 10 years. And the younger you are when that happens, the worse it is. So he has people in the cohort who are as young as 10. You can imagine, children who lose their parents, they're in a world of hurt. But it also has implications for 50-year-olds who are caregiving. Okay? So, now the question I got when I first started doing this work was like, so, what you gonna do about it? what can you do about it, right? It happens to everybody. Well, yeah, but, okay, so in our statistical models, the insomnia paper, which was written by the nurse in our group, Cherie Simpson, Cherie has a clinic where she treats people with cognitive behavioral therapy, which is a non-pharmacologic approach to insomnia control. Never occurred to her to ask them about loss. Okay? But now she does. So ask people about loss if they're complaining about being unable to sleep. In the paper that I wrote, I focused on overnight hospitalization and 20 or more doctor visits in a 2-year span. And the risk of that is elevated with a loss. So if someone's coming to you, if I'm back in my primary care mode days, and somebody keeps coming back into the office, I'm going to ask them about a loss because they're sick and the grief is making them sick. They may not acknowledge it, they may not realize, they may not put it together, but so that's the, so the exposure, you pick up the exposure. And in the last paper that my graduate student wrote, all my graduate students publish. And if you publish, I want to see it.
Okay, you will.
All right. He estimated your risk of dying conditional on having had a loss. We know for spouse pairs, we know this. He now has those estimates out there for parental loss, sibling loss, and child loss. And you imagine losing an adult child is quite devastating for the parents. So in all of those models, we also put in factors that might diminish the risk. The one thing comes through the models. I mean, really, I've never seen a protective effect this strong in any of them. It's mild physical activity. So the phrase we use is walk the bereaved. Walk the bereaved. You know, you don't have to run a marathon, you know, but just movement, it cuts the risk of insomnia in half, which is huge. It lowers the risk of subsequent mortality by 85%. I mean, it is huge. And we're not talking about, you know, Charles Atlas or Arnold Schwarzenegger type weightlifting. We're talking about any type of physical activity. So here's where the policy piece comes in. Medicare has a bereavement benefit. If you're in hospice, your surviving family gets 13 months of coverage for bereavement-related health effects. But there's no evidence-based approach. You know, it's all incense and candles. So, seriously, that's what I call it, because it's goofy. So one of the things I've been talking to the Georgia Hospice and Palliative Care Organization about is, let's have some kind of walking program. Let's do a clinical trial of walking among the newly bereaved. And look at these endpoints like overnight hospital stays, doctor visits, their own mortality. These are hard targets. And see if this is something that, you know, lay groups can pick up. I mean, it is something we're going to need, because in an aging society, we're going to hit, there's going to be a lot of loss, because the peak of the boom is moving into that stage of life. And then the millennials come back. You know, there are more millennials now than there are boomers.
I can imagine.
Yeah, well, there are. You don't have to imagine. There's more about this. So, you know, it's something as an aging society. So that's where the whole public health, public policy and mix come together. You can by implementation of mild physical activity, go bowling, you know, do something. It really lessens the risk of these other really bad outcomes. So, did I answer your question?
You did.
Okay.
It's why you don't want to be, you know, labeled as a gerontologist.
That's why I don't, because this, it focuses on, you know, oh yeah, so to bring that, you've heard all of the conversations around end of life, death and dying, all that other stuff.
Mm-hmm.
It all focuses on the person who's dying. And while I, you know, I totally get that, the people who stand around the bed are the ones who are injured by the process. The survivors, whether they're left without resources or they're left with a broken heart, their injury is propagated forward. That never gets brought up in the conversation. So.
Okay. Moving right along. Did you have any female mentors who impacted your move into agent? Let's say gerontology, but let's say agent.
So when I got started way, way back, there was a woman named Jackie Jackson. I don't know if you remember, you know, you would not remember her. She predates, you know, you've ever heard the name James Jackson? No. Wow. You're like fourth generation. Anyway, there's this lineage of black gerontologists. So at the time I came in, James Jackson, who's at University of Michigan, Robert Chatters and Linda Chatters, his wife, were the big black names in gerontology. They were sort of promoting, they were all focused on religiosity and blacks. And, you know, when I got into aging, the first paper I tried to get published, and this was with Marie Bernard, who's now deputy director at NIA, the editor, it was focused solely on blacks. There was no white comparison group in the paper. And he was like, "Where's the white comparison group?" It was the editor of the journal. Yes, he was like, I'm like, "This is not about white people. This is about black people." Well, okay. That was the reality thing. You could not write a scientific paper about African Americans without comparing them to whites. And so that trio, that's what they did. They wrote about black people. And so if you look at the University of Michigan now, they have this center on black aged. Well, they didn't study healthcare. James does mental health, and that's important. Linda and Robert study religiosity as a coping mechanism for mental illness. But they weren't focused on, I'm a physician, illness is what I do. And they didn't talk about any of that in any of their writings. And probably because the politics were not receptive to them doing that kind of work. So they were influential in what I chose to work on. And then there was a woman who predates James named Jackie Jackson. Jackie and Rose Gibson. I don't know if you, have you ever heard the name Rose Gibson? Look up Rose Gibson. Rose, unlike Jackie, Rose had a PhD. Jackie wrote about black elders, but she didn't have good formal scientific training. Rose, on the other hand, did. And Rose, both of their experiences were instrumental in helping me understand there's no back door to science. You have to go in fully armed and with a few extra weapons. That's why you never ever stop learning throughout your career. Even now, you know, I go online, I do courses at Khan Academy to learn more stuff. You just cannot quit learning, because if you do, then your research doesn't work. So I also watched a lot of really good people get messed up by being treated badly. And so that was very influential. And if you notice, I've been a lot of places.
You have. You've been a lot of places.
Yeah. But, you know, I don't... Some people like to stay and fight. They hunker down and they fight with the university. Universities will always crush you. They will always crush you. Because they're big. And you're one person. I also read a lot of biographies. So, Marie Curie, when I was a kid, she didn't have a PhD. And that held her up. Gotta have that sheepskin, you know. Ernest Everett Just. Do you know that name? Ernest Everett Just. He was a biologist back in the 1930s. He is the one that discovered in vitro fertilization.
Oh.
Okay. I read his papers when I was in graduate school. He, black man out of Howard. He worked for a while in Germany until the Nazis made life there unbearable. He described what happens and drew pictures. At the time, you know, it was all about drawing pictures of what happens when an egg and sperm come together in a petri dish. So we have in vitro fertilization because Just did the work. Very cool. So you have lots of scientists. Charles Drew. Do you know who Charles Drew is?
No, ma'am, I'm probably not gonna know. It is.
Oh my God!
That's what I'm writing about.
He did the work that made the modern blood banking system possible. So there are lots of men and women in science, African Americans, who, you know, more than just the peanut guy. We don't have to name him. But they get lost because science, you know, if you do good science and people just know the science and they really, you know, you look out on LinkedIn. I put in pictures of some big labs that I've visited.
Mm-hmm.
I got a chance to see Jackson Hole this summer in Bar Harbor, Maine. And then I have a picture of me in front of, not Jackson Hole, Jackson Labs. And then Woods Hole last summer. I like, you know, I'm a scientist. Did I answer that question?
You did.
Okay. I have to ask, because, you know, I can go blah. I'm telling you, I'm a full professor. I can blah, 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 blah.
So, what is unique about being a woman in your field? Let me flip to the next page.
Oh, God. Man, you have babies. Yeah, you know, you've got, you have babies. I mean, I was pregnant when I showed up at my first job in Chicago. That when I interviewed, I wasn't pregnant, and then 3 months later, I was. And fortunately, my first chairman, Paul Levy, who's the best chairman ever, you know, had 3 kids of his own, had a wife that had psychiatric problems. And so he understood what it took I had a husband, you know, I have a husband, and so I wasn't a single mom. That I just, oh my God, that's just really hard. But Paul Levy gave me the space to, because my daughter was born early, not really early, but, you know, she couldn't wait to get out. And it was December, and, you know, it gets slippery in Chicago, so waddling in and out of that building on icy steps was not something he didn't want me to do a lot of that. But, you know, you need people who are going to give you the space you need to do that. Really important, you know, I think it's important that you have love in your life. But a lot of women short themselves on that. You know, so what women have to do to have a satisfying personal life is harder in a lot of ways. So I've been very fortunate. The man I married is he's a special person. He's like Mr. Rogers, you know, he's special.
Those experiences that you were talking about, that the university makes it hard for you, do you think that that had anything to do with the fact that you're a woman, or do you think it's just, in general, the university makes it hard for people who work there?
Yes and yes.
That's that discourse of liberalism I'm
saying. Okay. I mean, and especially medicine, right? Medicine is a male, a very macho, to illustrate. So I went to Howard, which is an all-black medical school. But when I got, the year I got accepted, the class went from being 10% female to 50% female. Because we got a new dean, and he insisted that the most qualified people get accepted. He removed affirmative action for men. Okay? And so my class hit all the walls of maleness in medical school. We had, for example, there was this idiot in pathology who liked to make ridiculous sexual innuendo and not so innuendo type references. He showed up at an exam one time wearing this long green tie that hung almost down to his knees with a naked woman drawn on it. It's like, really, dude, really? You know, it's that kind of stuff. Because, you know, I was told, women, you know, you're taking up a seat that a good man could have and you might die in childbirth. Oh, yes. Oh, yeah. We're not too far off that mark. Those people are still here. So being a woman, even in the misogyny of Howard, in some ways, is shocking compared to more majority institutions. They feel like they can get away with more misogynistic behavior. I mean, I had a faculty member when I was doing my clerkships. This guy, he never saw your eyes. Like, you, honey. Oh. He would not know what you look like. He would just be the whole time he's talking to you. And it's like, and he's the chairman of internal medicine. Okay? Being a woman is, you know, I got a million of these stories. I'll just tell you one more.
Okay.
I'm in the ER doing, at night, you know, I'm on call, I'm doing chest compressions, and I got up, you know, because I got called, it was my turn. I'm doing chest compressions on this person who's dying, and my chief resident looks across, and he's like staring down my blouse, because it's like hanging over. It's worse for women in surgery. I have friends who did surgical. I mean, it's just crazy. It is just crazy. So, yeah, being a woman, it's an issue. Being black is an issue. I gave up a long time ago trying to figure out which person they didn't like. I just want the behavior to stop. That's my thing. It's like, I don't care why you're being bad, just stop it.
So, how is being a person who does aging, how has that interacted with your own personal aging process?
Ooh, man. Okay, so at this point in time, there's a research design that they use in social work called single subject design. It's discredited as an approach in other forms of science because it's not, you know, sample size and all of that. But it's the only thing that helps me understand what's happening to me. You know, so everything I've learned about what physical activity can do for you, why you need to sleep at night, why it's important not to let your emotions disrupt your rational thought, except the fact that you're gaining a little weight as you age.
Or a lot of weight.
It's all about function, baby. You know, like I swim better than I ever have. I swim distance. And seriously, I can do about a mile in about 45 minutes. And I'm not fast at all. But I don't stop. I'm like the Terminator of swimmers. The Swiminator is what my husband called me. And so all of that has helped me to understand the aging. What I know about aging has helped me to understand what's happening to me. Oh, I didn't tell you I was part of the group that studied the natural history of menopause.
No.
Yeah, I got my fingers in a lot of pies. When I was at Penn State, I was part of a team that worked on a study that was called SWAN, Study of Women Across the Nation. We recruited 16,000 women who were between the ages of 35 and like early to mid 40s, and watched them go through the menopausal transition. We had surveys that we did. We collected blood samples from some people. I mean, we studied that thing. First of all, what's the front end? Where is the front end of menopause? How do you know? And when are you done? So, let's see. I was about 40 when I joined that study. So it was very informative to me to learn about menopause because, you know, all you got is what you hear. You know, and what you hear is not very flattering or nice or, you know, and so now I understand basically it's not pathology. It is a part of our normal biology. There's nothing wrong with it. And what you have to do is manage the uncomfortable side effects of that transition. And so that's why I have a glass of chocolate soy milk every night. I love chocolate. And Silk is like the best soy milk ever. In the study, they had different racial and ethnic groups. So the Japanese women in the study had no word for hot flash. There's no word for hot flash anywhere. And we figured out that it's because the levels of the isoflavones that they get from soy are so high that they don't get hot flashes.
Oh.
And so I made a point to get a minimum of 25 grams of soy protein. I had to take out other things, otherwise you go But once I got to that level, I didn't have hot flashes either. You still have some of the other changes, but you don't have hot flashes. That's important. Because hot flashes disrupt your sleep. And anybody whose sleep is disrupted is going to look crazy and be grumpy. And so, you know, part of what people, the vision that people have of menopausal women is because they don't feel good. You know, their sleep is disrupted. The environment is not comfortable for them. I put a thermometer in my office. You look in my office now, you'll see a thermometer on the desk. And I started that when I was in Louisville because I would complain about it either being too cold or too hot in my office. And I would get dissed by some repair guy. Well, you know, women. So whatever office I'm working in, I have a thermometer and it has a humidity reading. So when I complain, see this, buddy? It's cold in here, or it's hot in here, or the humidity is like off the charts. When we first moved into the Institute building, there were nothing but women there. And all of us were like, this is ridiculous. It feels like a swamp in here. So this guy, oh, you know, you got a bunch of women. And then I showed him the data. The humidity said high. It didn't say 100%. It said high. It was like beyond 100%. He's like, oh, that means the equipment's wrong. So he fixed it. You know, so I've learned you cannot, you must be data driven. You must be data driven. And you know, you stick up for yourself. So yeah, my own aging, I am the expert of me.
Now, the WIGL project is focused on the legacies of older women, gerontologists, or and aging. So within that framework, is there anything else that you would like to talk about?
Well, the legacy piece.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so for me, the trained minds that I've left behind are, that's immortality in the academic terms. People that you train, papers that you write. That's why I tell my assistant professors, if you want to achieve immortality, write a paper. The guy I did my PhD with was trained by a guy who was trained by a guy who was trained by Henry Gray. Do you know who Henry Gray is?
Do not.
Oh, man. Okay, so Henry Gray wrote Gray's Anatomy.
Okay. Really?
Gray's Anatomy. And what Henry Gray always focused on was structure and function. So is there some anatomical structure? What is that structure? What kind of function does that structure support? And so, you know, that's why we have our long bones support our upright posture. You know, that concept moves forward. And so with each iteration, if you look back at all the work that all of us have done in that lineage, the questions always turn on structure and function in some way. Now, it gets a little far out when you get to some of the other work that I do, but, you know, it's the minds that you train and the people that you influence. That's really all it boils down to.